This talk is about a doctrine that exists for many years in the Pentecost, and the majority of churches believe that. It's about we're not under the Lord, but under grace. And there's also the together God's by grace we are saved, and by faith alone we are saved. It is what I really don't understand, that people don't understand. It's the most controversial or the most confusing message from the scriptures, from the Bible. The majority of people do not understand to discern the Lord and grace. I want you to understand that the word of the Lord is the law. Whatever God says is a law. And if we take it that way, the way they present it, in other words, the Old Testament is no longer applicable to us then. That is not true. The Old Testament ceremonious laws, they done away through Christ. In other words, the sacrifices, the circumcision of the skin, the tabernacle made with hands, the temple made with hands, the priesthood, the sacrifices of the animals, all these things are done away. But his word endures forever. And so the way they presented, I'm going to read a few things to you. Before I read these things from, I actually zoomed last night by faith, we're saved by faith alone, and it's an incredible the things come in front of me. But before I go there, I want to read a few scriptures to you to see that what the Lord says from the very beginning, his word endures forever. He never ceases. And we in book of Psalms, don't need to turn to this particular verse. I'll read it to you, and then I'll give you other verses to read. He says, verse 33, verse 5 says, he loveth righteousness and judgment. So the Lord loves righteousness and judgment. We see through this is God's goodness. Go to Psalm 25, verse 8. Psalms 25, verse 8. Just one verse. It says, good and upright is the Lord. Therefore will he teach sinners in the way. So what we're looking now is the goodness of the Lord. God gave commandments, the laws and statutes to his people so that they might live by it, not to be like the other nations. They were free to do whatever they liked. They had no law to break, no conscience, no direction. Because God, the Creator, he chosen Israel from the very beginning, and he chosen us before the foundation of the world too, but he's dealing at the time with the children of Israel as a father. And a father gives a good instruction to his people, to his children. And he did that. He wanted them to be different. He wanted them to live a good life, to have a unity and harmony amongst themselves. That's why he says, I read the scripture before to you, he loveth righteousness and judgment. He judged his people with equity, with righteousness. And now he says here, he teaches sinners into the way that should go. He teaches his people to be corrected. Now, I just want to read this information I have for you. Just, we're going to touch some scriptures in a context. And so you'll see how deceived is this particular approach. We have lost two families. Listening to people like that and approaching, we lost them, completely gone. Somebody tried to ring me. I don't know how to cut him off. Sorry about that. Okay. There are 37 scriptures. Listen to what they're saying. The 37 scriptures that prove, just a minute, I'll put it better than this. The 37 scriptures that prove that Christians are not under the law. Now give the first one. I'm going to touch a few, okay? To see how deceived they are. The first one is in Acts chapter 15, verse 10. It says, the law is an unbearable yoke. The Lord, look at the side. The law is an unbearable yoke. Now, if you read this particular chapter, from verse 1, because this is it, they're taking verses out of context. Not to go there, you started in verse 10, and I will explain what it says. They're having spirit-filled people and certain Jewish people. They said the Gentiles must be circumcised so they can be saved to have salvation. And Peter stands in the midst and says this, verse 10, no, we just need to go in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15, verse 10. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15, verse 10. I'll make the comment what I say again. It says this particular verse is best I caught in. The Lord is an unbearable yoke. Now Peter stood out and says to the people that demanding to circumcise the people, and he says to them, now therefore, my brother, why tempting ye God to put yoke upon the neck of this of the disciples, which is neither our fathers nor we are able to bear. Because whether you're demanding is for the people after being spirit-filled coming to the Lord to be circumcised on their skin. Now I'll give you the next one, okay? You have to listen carefully so you can see the deception here. I'm going to read Romans 4, verse 15. What I say is, the law brings wrath upon those who follow it. The Lord, the God of commandments of the Lord, brings wrath to those that follow them. Listen to the scripture where it says, because the law worketh wrath, for where is no law, there is no strength. In other words, if you don't have a speed limit when you're driving, you don't break any law. So God's laws come on the scene. It says, do not sin, do not do this, do not do that, because if you do, this is the consequences. They say, look how different they read it. They say, verse 15 we're reading. Just a second. The law bringeth wrath upon those who follow it. So opposite, because the law worketh wrath, for where there is no law, is there is no transgression. Now look at the next one. The next one is Romans 7, verse 10. It says here, the law which is promised life only bring death through sin. In other words, what I say, the law of God is brings death. Through sin. Let's have a look at it. It says here, that the commandment which was ordained to life is found to be unto death. So the commandment God gave us so the children not to sin so they can find life. They use it opposite. The next one. I'm not going to have a few more, and then you get the message across. Romans 7, verse 13. The law makes you sinful beyond measure. God's law makes you sinful beyond measure. That's what they say. That's why I say we're not under law. Look how they're twisting it, because they don't want any law. They don't want any rules in their church. They open up to anything. That's why they have thousands of followers, and they're making people tickle their ears, they make them feel good, and they have thousands of people follow them. And here it says, was then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid. But sin that might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful. How wrong is to sin against God? What's the next one now? This thing was just one more. Romans 8, verse 3. He says, the law, God's law is weak. Look what it says. God's law, that says, is weak. Here it says, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak, through the flesh, through our flesh. God sending his only son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemning sin in the flesh, so we can be separated from death and sin, and give us his spirit to be able to live by the laws and the commandments and statutes of God. It's a big deception. But let's go to the word of God now. What I'm highlighting, not only how wrong is this idea, but to recognize now that by the grace of God, well equipped to be able to live, to empower us to live by the grace of God as a servant to Christ. Let's go and have a look now to Romans chapter 2. We read from verse 4 to 8. It's important, brothers and sisters, to share these things because people listening to a lot of other doctrines, it sounds good, but if you don't know the word of the Lord, they caught in scripture out of context. Chapter 2, verse 4 to 8. Or despise thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God lead thee to repentance. But after the hardness of the impenitent heart, treasure up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath, a revelation of the righteous judgment of God. So in other words, also what I believe, you know, it doesn't matter what you do, Jesus loves you, you know the law, don't worry about it too much. They don't put any effort. Here it talks about the judgment of God is going to come. And the goodness of the Lord, leading us to repentance. He doesn't want us to miss out. The letter is written to the church. It's not written in the Old Testament, that's what written now. Who will render to every man, verse 6, according to his deeds, to them who by passion and continue in well-doing, seek for glory and honor and immortality, and eternal life. But unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath. So the judgment is going to come. And the Lord is telling us not to fall upon this type of teachings, not to listen to this type of people, because they are deceiving people. Sounds all good. Never cite anything to harm you. Never cite the severity of the Lord. And the Bible talks about to behold his goodness and the severity of the Lord. So we're gonna see a few more scriptures about the law of the Lord. We go to Psalms 19, verses 7 to 9. Psalm 19, verses 7 to 9. We'll read from there. And it says, the law of the Lord is perfect. God's word is perfect, converting the soul. So the purpose of God's law is perfect to convert the soul. You know what that means, convert the soul? Is to restore our soul, because we were dead in sin and trespasses. And even after we come to the Lord now, we stand in this privileged position from the very beginning and now, God's word never changed. He wants us to save our souls. He gives us rules, because he's not going to compromise. He pays a precious price that his son died on the cross for all humanity, so they will not perish. God's love, he does not want any man to perish. And he says, I read it again, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the law is pure and enlightening the eyes. And I say, we're not of the law. Misquoting scriptures. Deliberately misquoting scriptures. He says, 37 scriptures say, testifying, witnessing that we're not under the law. We're not under the law. Which is rather how misquoted they are. Let's go, brothers, to Romans 3. I read it to you. Just one verse. Do we then make void the law? This is in the New Testament. You can go there, verse 31. Verse 31, Romans 3, verse 31. He says, do you then make void the law through faith? God forbid. We establish the law through faith, because we believe what God came to do for us through Christ. And we are able now through his spirit to live by the law of God. We cannot live by the word of the Lord of God without the Spirit dwelling in us. And if you have the Spirit, if you are in the flesh, we cannot live by the Lord of God. We still can do the wrong things, because God doesn't matter robots. He gave us a free will, brothers and sisters. Matthew chapter 5. We read from 17 to 18. Matthew 5. Now, we read in all these things to establish what Jesus came to do, to separate how wrong that doctrine is, this view, is not of God, 100%. When you misquote in scriptures, deliberately misleading people, is a dangerous thing. But here we say what Jesus came in accomplished. We're going to see that. Matthew 5, verse 17 and 19. He says, "Think not that I come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heavens and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall not wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled." Jesus came and fulfilled the law. And now because he fulfilled the law and he chosen us by his grace, and we are dead, we are free from death and sin by being baptized into Christ and receive his spirit, his law now, because Christ he dwells inside us by his spirit, we're able to fulfill the law, because we all come short of the glory of God. We couldn't fulfill the law. Now we're taking the by the law. The word of the Lord endures forever. John chapter 1, 14 to 18. This is an interesting one here. John chapter 1, from verses 14 to 18. I hope you can follow me, brothers and sisters. If you miss a few things, listen again. It's very important, because it's dangerous doctrines out there. He says, verse 14, "And the word was made flesh," because Jesus is the word of God. When I say, "Not under the law," it's the word of God also, that is finished. It says, "The word was made flesh and dwell among us. And we behold his glory, the glory of us, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." John bear witness of him, and Christ saying, "This was he of whom I speak. He that come after me is preferred before me, for he was before me." Listen to this particular verse, what it says. "And of his fullness have we all received, and grace for grace." What do you mean, grace for grace? Because he's referring to Jesus, because he is the word of God. The word of God is full of grace and mercy, because his throne is a mercy seat and the throne of grace. And he is the one who sits on. And he came. Now he appeared first, so he can bring us into his rest, to bring us into his grace. The grace, he says, "And his fullness we all have received, and grace for grace." So the Old Testament word, it was the grace of God given to his people. Now it's fulfilled in us, because he took a form of a flesh and he came in this well to fulfill the law himself. He's the only one who can fulfill the law, to be the perfect sacrifice. And he died for us, so he came to dwell inside us. For the law was given by Moses, and grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man has seen God at any time, the only begotten of the Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he had declared him. How he declared him? But because he came, being the express image of his person, he's revealing his holiness, his truthfulness, his love, everything, and self-sacrifice for all humanity. Otherwise, we have no idea who God is. But he is the express image of this person. So the Old Testament was Christ. That's why it says, from Christ to Christ. grace and grace for grace. Now, the next verse, Romans chapter 7, let's go to connect it with these people a bit more. I'm spending too much time on this. Romans 7, 7 to 13. Chapter 7, verse 7 to 13. Good. Thank you. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Now I had no know sin but by the law. For I had no knowledge, no lust, except the law say that should not cover. Like I said, if you have a speed limit, that's a good example to put. Then you exceed the speed limit, you're breaking the law, you pay a fine. No speed limit, the police cannot book you. Ask Butch afterwards. But sin, taking the occasion by the commandment, brought in me all manner of complaints. For there is, without law, sin was dead. For I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. And the commandment which was ordained to life, so the commandment, it was not given so we can die. It was ordained to life. I found to be death, to be unto death, because we can all live the commandments without Christ in the being. Okay? For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me and by it, it slew me. Because if you disobey and put the commandments of the Lord, you don't apply that in your life, don't live by, you're dead. So the Lord is sinless, the same, still the same commandments is applicable. If you disobey them, that's the consequences. Again, wherefore the Lord is holy. Listen to this. The Lord is holy, and the commandment is holy, and just is good. What's then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid. But sin, that may appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful. He's telling us, he highlights how serious it is to sin against God. Because God doesn't want us, he's not going to compromise. Doesn't matter what you do, you come into my presence. If what is the case, then we could have gone by the Old Testament. And nobody can be in the presence of the Holy God with the Old Testament. Because Jesus, I have to explain this so you don't be confused. He is the resurrection and the life for all humanity, including the Old Testament people. If Jesus didn't come, there's no resurrection. Whatever they did and they died in the grave, that's what they died. Jesus, if you read in the Old Testament, I don't want to go too much on this, he was always there with them, followed them through the wilderness. He was the manna, he was the rock, he was the water, he was everything. It was the cloud, it was the light, the fire by night. He was always there with them. The spirit that followed them was Christ. So everything consists in the life of God through expressed through Jesus Christ, the plan of God in everything. And so I'll leave it there because I go to other things because I had Romans. It says similar things, verse 1 to 4. You read it yourselves. So you see, the problem was the flesh, it was not the Lord. We are the problem, not the Lord. The commandment is just as good and it's holy and it's pure and it's ordaining for life, not death. We are dead anyway. People were dead without God's law. And when he came, he shows to his people at the Old Testament how if they want to live and to be in his presence, they must live by his commandments, by his laws, by his statutes. And so the same laws and commandments and statutes still applicable to us today, even though we are spirit-filled. Okay. I just, my time is running, but I got to James 2, because I'm not gonna run out of time. I'm missing scripture. James 2 verses 18, to 18. It's quite a few verses here. He says here, verse 8, start from. If you fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, that you love thy neighbor as thyself, you do well. A neighbor as thyself is the first command. The first commandment is to love the Lord thy God with all thy mind, all soul, and thy neighbor as thyself. And it says here, if you feel that, you're doing well. None of us could do it before that, before Christ came. To love somebody else, equal to yourself, even a stranger, even people that are doing wrong, to love them in the same way. But if you have respect for persons, you commit sin and are convinced of the law as transgressor. Whosoever should keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. This is not the Old Testament book we're reading. This is written in the New Testament. For he that says, do not commit adultery, say also, do not kill. Now, if they are committed adultery, yet if they are killed, they are become a transgressor of the law. See, the law still apply. You can't say now, I don't live under the law. I can commit a go with another woman. I can kill. No problem. So speak ye and so do, as they that should be judged by the law of liberty. Is more severe to the spiritual people. For he should have judgment without mercy. Also now he's telling us how to display mercy. He's telling us because the goodness and the severity of the law. For he should have judgment without mercy, that hath shown no mercy, and mercy rejoice against judgment. The only thing we can ascribe the judgment of the Lord to be merciful. Be ye merciful, for I am merciful, says the Lord. Okay. And what he profited, brethren, thou a man say he has faith. What was written here? Liberty, judgment. Okay. Verse 14. What does he profit, brethren? The man say he has faith, he have no works. Can faith save him? As I said, by faith alone we all saved. Don't do anything. If a brother or sister be naked and is destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warm and filled, notwithstanding you give them not those things which is needful to the body, what doth he profit? Even so faith, if it has no works, it is dead, being alone. Faith without all actions, being alone is dead. In other words, you're dead. God didn't give us the spirit in vain. God gave us his love, his mercy, his trust, his goodness, his compassion for us. And he still does every day the things we do wrong. We want to be forgiven from the Lord. But we find it difficult to forgive somebody else. Oh, he has to testify first. It was not my wrong. It's his person's wrong, not mine. Well, what I'm doing wrong is nobody else's wrong. It's mine. But God forgives me, because if he doesn't forgive me, I have no chance to be in the kingdom of heaven. So you and I, brothers and sisters. So faith alone, without works, is dead. Okay, let's go to Philippians chapter 2. He empowers, now he's given us power. We need to recognize that, brothers and sisters, to become a servant. Because to be merciful, you have to become a servant. And that's the example Jesus is showing us here. Philippians chapter 2. I had a Titus chapter 3. You read it for homework if you want to. There, actually, I might go there because it's an important one. No, I'll leave it. I'm sorry. I'll leave it because I'm not going to have time to finish what I want. I don't want to drag it too long. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5-7. No, 5, actually 4-8, we're going to read. Verse 4-8. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. It doesn't tell you not to look after yourself, but don't look after for yourself only, but you have to look after for others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it no robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And be found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. So the encouragement, brothers and sisters, is to be put on the mind of Christ. This is the mind of Christ. If we don't put on the mind of Christ, we cannot be servants. We cannot please God. Many scriptures we're going to have time to go through today, because I'm emphasizing that give us power to become a servant. We like to be served. We like things people to do for us. We like people to acknowledge us. We like people to be to respect us and to see us, you know, that we are there. But the way we feel and we want all these things, we ought to be able to return and unto others. And this is the example the Lord has seen us. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10. Just one verse. First Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 10. Verse 10. 1-0. That's good. But by the grace of God, this is Paul's writes, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. In other words, he recognized his calling, but he took up his responsibility because he didn't receive the grace of God in vain, without a value, and doing nothing. But I labor more than abundantly than they all, yet not I, by the grace of God, which was with me. In other words, he doesn't elevate himself. The motivation, the strength, the desire, all this proceeds from God, nothing for ourselves. But he understood his calling. His calling, his understanding, the grace of God was not in vain. He took up the momentum. And that's the encouragement now I'm leading to. We identify how wrong this doctrine is and how precious the word of the Lord is, how the severity and the goodness of the Lord. But now we need to recognize we are chosen of God. We are special. We are precious in his sight. He wants to bless us continuously. He doesn't want to lose us and all these things. But his desire of our Heavenly Father to see us all together in unity first in the church, to have a testimony to reflect to the people in your family, to the people at work, wherever we go, wherever we are, on thy Zoom and come and see us, the seers united, the seers one. And that's the desire of my Heavenly Father. For by doing this, we glorify him. How can we, as a human beings, give glory and power and strength to the Lord? He's the Almighty God. But our testimony, when we allow his love, his goodness to be in us and manifested, we give power and strength to the Lord, because people will see us and glorify God, that God is alive. That's what is leading us. To be a servant, to deny ourselves, to be a living sacrifice. It's good that we identify the wrong and the right and all that, but we need to identify ourselves that we're standing and being tuned with God. That's the important part now we're looking to. In Deuteronomy 10 to 1 Peter 2, it says, leaving us an example to follow his footsteps. That means whatever, not just follow his footsteps. I said this before, wherever he went and you look at a map, exactly what he did, his behavior, what he said, how he dealt with difficulties, how he stood unmovable, how he reached and he was merciful. That's what it means, follow his steps. In the Greek word, it means ichni, it's more than just steps. First Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to read first one verse. We have to recognize our ministry. Verse 1. And then after verse 1, we're going to go 5 and 12. Verse 1 first. Let a man so count us as of the ministers of Christ. So the people that must account or recognize us as the ministers or representing Christ and the stewards of the mysteries of God. He trusted us with the words of life. Made us miss his testimony, his ambassadors. Ambassador is a person who lives in another country, represents his country. We are not of this world. Taken out of this world. And what you represent in is the kingdom of heaven. Let's go on. And it says verse 5 to 12 there. From verse 5 to 12. Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts. Then so every man, including us, have praise of God. And these things, brethren, I have in a figure transferred to myself, first to himself and to Apollos, for your sakes, that you might learn in us not to think of man above that he which is written, that no one of you be puffed up for one against another. In other words, your humility that was serving, representing Christ, not themselves. Verse 7, for whom make thee to differ from another, and what thou that thou this not receive, how is thou this receive it? Why does thou glory if thou hast not received it? Now you are full and you are rich. You have raiment and as kings without us, and will to God you divine, that we also might reign with you. But I think that God hath sent for us the apostles last, as we are appointed to death, for we are made a spectacle unto the world, and to angels and to them, and so on. So we see what it was leading to. It was bringing a recognition, acknowledging that actually representing and the authority and the thing the Lord had put us in charge, not to take it upon ourselves to recommend ourselves, but to recommend Christ, and so on. And not to, if something we receive, it, not to be boastful there, because it can get to our heads and we can lose our humility, and then we're not going to be led by the Spirit of God, and so on. It's very dangerous. Okay, we'll go first, Peter. I'll read from verse chapter 5, verse 1 to 10. I'm going to run a bit longer. I took a long path today. First Peter chapter 5, 1 to 10. The elders which are among you, I exhort, who are also an elder, I am also an elder, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also partaker of the glory that should be revealed. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of ready mind, because people doing and serving themselves. These people with a doctrines of prosperity, and so on, is for their own pockets. They become millionaires. Some is boasting, they become a billionaires. And so that's why the reason I took this. Neither has been lost over God's heritage, but being as examples to the flock. This applies to the oversight or the people that are standing at the front and leading whatever we lead in, brothers and sisters, brother, especially, this is referred to a man here. And when the chief shepherd should appear, you should receive a crown of glory, the fight and not a why. Likewise, you younger, submit yourselves unto the elder, yea, all of you. What verse was written? You threw me out. Verse 5. Likewise, you younger, submit yourselves unto the elder, yea, all of you, be subject to one to another, and be clothed with humility. For God resisted the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty God of God, hand of God, that he might exalt you in the due time, casting all your cares upon him, for he care for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because the adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he might devour. If you take all these points, not be humble, not be respectful, it's a deception. The devil wants to deceive us. If you do it not because of love and serving the Lord, you're looking after the flock, but if you do it for the other motives, you'll be deceived by the devil. That's what he's leading us to all these things in a context. That's the opposition. He doesn't want us to do it according to the pattern of the Lord Jesus. He doesn't want that. Whom resists steadfast in the fight, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplishing in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who has called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered well, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. It's only through him and for him and by him continuously we're able to stand. Without him, we are nothing. If we draw to him, we abide in the vine, all these attributes, all this goodness, all these examples, all this willingness, all these clear thoughts of evil things that come and floating around us, that they are bombarding us with all the things that we see on the iPhones and wherever we go around us in the world. It's darkness. We need to find rest and rescue under the shadow of the Almighty by praying the Spirit, by reading his word, by allowing his goodness, his love to overflow in our lives, to reflect, to be a testimony to have a unity, to be one with him. I cover a lot of things here, but I don't want to go too many other things. I have, for those that have a study, you know, the writing notes, 2 Peter chapter 1, 2 to 11, is very important to read it. In Hebrews 4:16 is the we encourage us to go before the throne of grace to find mercy and to find rescue of the Lord in many other difficulties. When Jesus says, I'm going to my Father's house, are many mansions. I go and prepare a place for you. He didn't say, he didn't go to heaven to build condominium so we can live in together. He sits on the right hand of God. He understands our weakness. He understands our fears. He understands everything for us. He's there to mediate for us because we continue need to be led by him. And only through his mercy we'll be able to stand to the day when we return. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, we'll read there. Verse 18. I cut it short now because I already passed my time. Verse 18. By growing grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to him be glory both now and forever. Amen. He tells us to grow in grace, to go from strength to strength. He says, the outgoing man perish, the inner man must renew it day by day. It's a daily walk. And how it's accomplished, he says, Jesus says, it encourages us to pray, to ask, to go before him and say, give us this day our daily bread. His word will sustain us. His word will keep us. His word takes all fears away from us. His word, he shows us why we should make decisions. Sometimes we want to make a decision forever, whatever it is, small or great. And we already made our minds and said to the Lord, Lord, this is what I want to do. Blessed to me, Lord. He says, Lord, this is what I want to do. If it is good for me, it's not going to be a problem because I can't see everything. Blessed Lord. If it is not, I will have a peace. He says he will hold nothing good from his children. All the promises of Christ, of God, are written for us to obtain brothers and sisters for his glory. Let us put on the mind of Christ, follow his footsteps. The love of God keeps us together. She's figgy. It keeps us that close. He doesn't want us to let us go. He doesn't want us to be lost in the confusion of the false doctrines. He wants us to be aware. That's why I touched this particular point, because we lost two families in our Darwin scholarship. And now we're here from here and there, and you know what happens? I'm giving this because a lot of the message also was for the people that are giving talks or standing at the front. A lot of even in our fellowship, you know what happened? They're listening to other two speakers. And sometimes you hear certain things and say, we are not under the Lord anymore. Only by faith alone we are saved. And it's happening. We have to be aware, brothers and sisters, especially the brothers that are standing at the front and control things. Sometimes I'm not there. But the grace of God are listening. I know it's not part of my talk, but I just said it in a little bit more. So good things, because it's a lot of danger out there. And I have a very good ear. I listen to everything, not because I want to catch people out. It's just, I'm interested to listen. When you listen and you know what is right, what is the good doctrine, sound doctrine, you can recognize what is not right. If you don't know what is right, doesn't matter how much you listen, you're going to accept it. Sounds good. Let us be careful, brothers and sisters. All of us, because we listen to other things. We've got to be careful. God bless you all.